That's it, you little fucking son of a bitch. Right now. Come here. You little fuck nugget. Come on. Stop it. Stop the fucking car, you little fuck. Come on, stop the car. Fuck. Come on, you little fuck nugget.
Were you trying to get crazy with this, eh? Don't you know I'm loco?
YouTube is a snake, constantly shedding its skin with iteration upon iteration upon iteration of how the website presents itself to the user. This change is usually inspired by a smug know-it-all dev that thinks that your usability and familiarity with the feature set is secondary to their artistic vision. But this wasn't always the case. Back in the day, those changes were much more gradual and spaced out, and the differences much more minor in comparison to what we see happen now. A video featured on the front page may garner a few hundred thousand views. Nowadays, a fat Korean man can hit that same amount within minutes rather than hours. But it's more than just the amount of eyes that were on a particular video. It was the content itself. With everything being so new and different, people that were innovative got attention. It's how people like the AVGN built up their celebrity status. They were the first person to do it. It inspired imitators, people that wanted to be just like that. Some outright stole the gag. Others tried to give their own variation of it, even spawning their own imitators who were an imitation of their imitation. And some people, well, fuck, we're not even, you know, that's a different video altogether. But nevertheless, you can see how the AVGN ended up becoming a genre in himself by simply doing something that nobody else had done before, and how all these people wanted to do that exact same thing. And the market became flooded, fucking flooded with angry video game reviewers. And one of those reviewers was the Game Dude. And just who is the Game Dude? Well, he's the gamer with a bad attitude. The Game Dude, aka Alexander, was a Canadian film student who was inspired by the AVGN. In fact, he didn't state that he made reviews. They were satirical comedic parodies of angry reviewers on YouTube. And that must have been paying off because he was the 85th most subscribed comedian from Canada. And just what form of comedy did Alexander present? What was the flavor of his videos? Well, let's take a look at a few clips to give you a good idea of what it was that Alexander liked to do.
Barbie is one of those shitty games, lost in the ocean of shitty games, that fulfilled its purpose of being a shitty game.
Look at Barbie. What a scary bitch.
And if that's not enough of a hint for how much he liked to ape the AVGN when it came to doing these satirical comedic parodies, here's another clip to really drive it home.
Rocky and Bullwinkle. More like Rocky Bullshit. This game is a tiger taking a diarrhea of my ass. This game is a buck full of rotten, disintegrating, regurgitated squirrel moose shit mixed in a blender. I'd rather clean the shitty asshole than giant panda using my tongue. It sucks so much it fucks so much it blows, it's the abomination of all time, a waste of time, and it's time to put an end to this ignominious travesty.
And strangely enough, believe it or not, he was actually recognizable for what he did, at least up in Canuckland. In the land of the Maple Leafs, he was kind of a big deal, because when he would walk into his local game store, they would do interviews with him.
I've talked to him a few times, just like, with only by like letters, pretty much, because, you know, every time I try to talk to him on the internet, he never replies. I'm not like some weird, creepy, you know, guy with like a giant picture of the angry video game nerd in my living room that I like, yeah.
See, I like to call that foreshadowing, that question, are you stalking him? It's a little bit of foreshadowing for what's coming up. Now, I'm sure you can gather by the video series this is, Internet Insanity, we're not here to talk about Alexander's fucking awful YouTube videos, or his now defunct channel. That's not what makes him interesting. He's interesting for something completely unrelated to the YouTube videos. You see, Alexander met a young girl, a girl he loved deeply, because he's a nice guy. And she just didn't understand how much he appreciated her. And I can think of no better segue into exactly what it was that happened than this particular clip.
Well, I want one that's nice, but then again, most of the nice ones are kind of, you know, fat, unfortunately. I'm also looking for, you know, one that looks hot. Then again, a lot of the hot ones are bitches, so it's like really, you gotta find one in the middle, and that's the trick. You gotta find one in the middle. Yeah, just, you know, she's gotta have like big tits and nice ass, and she's gotta be.
Young love can be a compelling thing, and that is the situation that Alexander found himself in. He was in love with a girl named Alana. Now, Alana was to him, as he put it, his everything. She was the star around which his world turned. He was convinced that she was the one that he was destined to spend the rest of his life with. Their relationship to him was the first of its kind. He had never been in love before. He had never had a girlfriend before. He had never been intimate with anybody before. And so he was completely swept up in the process and dedicated himself to trying to make that relationship work. And for a few years, things went okay until 2012, when the couple began to hit a rough spot. Now, according to Alexander and some of the videos that he released, they had an open relationship around this time. And apparently, Alana found something outside the relationship during that time that was better than what Alexander was offering. Because by July of that year, by July of 2012, they were officially over. Now you can imagine, poor Alexander, this film student from Canada who has this recognizable YouTube review channel. He's utterly shattered by this. Alana is the woman that he loves, and he will try to win her back in any way that he possibly can. I mean, hell, we've all heard this script before. Hollywood pumps these out by the dozens. We're talking a romantic comedy. Here's this poor schmuck that's in love with a girl that found somebody else, and he's going to win her back. What could possibly be more romantic than that? She must have been just awestruck by his dedication to her. Alexander even went so far as to do romantic music videos to try to win Alana's heart back. Rick Astley, a little John Lennon. What woman wouldn't absolutely love that? Well, apparently, Alana. Wow, he is really screwed up. He's so obsessed, I think he follows me, and he keeps phoning me. He's such a creep. Yes, tell him to leave me alone, or I'll call the police. I already did file a police report. I'm not joking, okay? He needs to stop thinking it's a joke. Did I fail to mention the police reports? Or the court case, or the massive amount of legal troubles that ended up driving Alexander to flee the country. I probably should back this story up a little bit. Well, it turns out that maybe Alexander went a little too full throttle in trying to win back the girl that he loves. Now, I have to walk a really fine line with this, because there's a bit of history I probably should explain before we go forward. A long time ago, this information was actually up and public on the internet. And that's because Alexander put up a lot of this himself, as well as other people that had interactions with Alana and her family. However, that quickly came to an end when these messages were sent to different people hosting that content. Now, the individual self-identifies as somebody working for the Crown Prosecution Services and threatens legal action if this information isn't pulled down from the internet. Well, what information is that? Well, that would be the court documents, the police reports, the 911 call, and the witness interviews. All of which I have. Now, I have to try to find a way to present this information to really give you the full story without actually showing you this information. Because the last thing I want is some maple syrup-loving, LARPing Canadian to threaten to prosecute me because I'm talking about something they don't want me to talk about. I'm not going to reveal the identity of who Alana is. I know. I have the full name and everything. I'm not going to tell you that. I will show you screen caps that were publicly available. I will show you videos and blogs that were publicly available. However, when it comes to the police reports and court documents, I will give you a basic idea of what's in it, but I will not quote word for word, and I can't show it to you. But I do have access to it, because somebody that archived this kept a complete collection of it. So what do those court documents say? I mean, how infatuated with Alana was Alexander? What was the game dude getting on up to with his spare time? Well, shortly after their breakup in 2012, Alexander, how would I put this? He went off the fucking deep end. He thought that if he dedicated every single fucking second of his waking day to trying to get her back, that that was the approach that was going to get her. I think he might have miscalculated. Because if you're calling somebody 60 times a day, stalking their house for upwards of 7 hours at a time, sitting across from it, and watching people come and go, talking to the neighbors, contacting family members, and even hiding in the bushes at night waiting for an opportunity to talk to the girl that you love as she leaves to go hang out with her friends, that might be interpreted as something other than smitten. Now, for those people that were subscribed to the Game Dude and wondered, hey, what happened to his content? He was doing all these game reviews and then they sort of stopped. Oh, you know, he was dedicating himself to other things as the legal process was moving forward, because Alana not only filed police reports, not only did her mother file police reports, but there was actually an upcoming court case related to this. So basically, Alexander had the idea to back the fuck off, but he wasn't looking for a suggestion. Instead, he thought it would be a good idea to start uploading some very bizarre videos. And when I say bizarre, I'm talking like filming wildlife and then just uploading it. Sometimes there was commentary, sometimes there wasn't. Take a look at a smorgasbord of some of the animal videos that Alexander was releasing at around this time.
Hey, want some chocolate? Look. Chocolate goose. Chocolate. Aw, you suck. Hello, lizard. Hello. How do you do, lizard? So, this video needs to be made right now.
Now, Alexander by this time was aware of what was going on. He knew that they were in talks with the police and that the government might be getting involved. There was a court case coming up. He understood that. So what effect did that have? Did he stop doing what he did? No. Instead, he decided to start fucking with the police. He was convinced that they were screwing with him. So he decided the best course of action was to fuck with every cop that he came across as he was filming his animal videos.
Shia, what is your badge number?
2355.
And yours?
You can read, right? Free to tape all you want. How long is it going to go? Just curious.
Where is it? Where is it? Come on. Come on, what is the fucking... What is... Oh, bitch, get the fuck out of here! Fucking piece of shit. You keep following me, I'll call the police and get you on stalking. Now get the fuck out of here.
Now, people at the time who knew him thought he was starting to act very strangely. I'm not even talking about Alana and her family. I'm just talking about people that were fans of his or people that he talked to on social media. So, he wanted to get his story out. What better way to convince people that you're not fucking insane and stalking a woman, calling her house 60 times a day? What better way to convince them that that, you know, isn't weird than by making a two-hour-long toy dinosaur documentary detailing your relationship and breakup? Nothing says stability like playing with children's toys and recreating your heart being broken.
Hey, yo. Oh, by the way, I'm not the same guy, that put
his arm around her shoulder. I'm a different guy.
And I look up, and she's right in front of me. I'm like, holy fuck. She's like, you're stalking me. You're looking for me. And I'm like, yeah, I was looking for you so hard that I did not see you standing right in front of me. It hurts me more than it hurts you. Self-defense? No, she was just angry. Like, I was like, yo, take this letter. Take it. You must take it. And I, like, take duct tape, and I duct tape the letter on her hand. I'm like, take the letter. She's like, fine.
Now, there was a lot going on beyond the initial reported behaviors of pestering phone calls or hanging around her house or stalking her around the neighborhood, to which Alexander, in his infinite wisdom, directly responds to her and her mother while a police investigation is going on. There were also potential allegations hinted at and discussed about domestic violence, as well as notifications about being a person of interest because he was a gun owner. So you've got a real mixture there. Won't leave the woman alone, calls her all the time, hanging out in the neighborhood, won't take no for an answer, has a gun, might be potentially violent, filming bizarre videos and uploading them, making love ballads and sending them to her. You can see there's a recipe for disaster there. Now, in the final few months, as the police investigation is wrapping up, as Alana is explaining a few more details, they're talking about the incidents that have occurred over the last year, and having to contact the police upwards of 4 times about Alexander's behavior, Alexander decides, hey, you know what, fuck it, I'm going to leave the country. I'm just going to, you know what, fuck Canada. I'm going to Mexico. And it's on his journey to Mexico, while all of this is going on, that he writes his perspective on what's going on. This is when he presents his magnum opus, his manifesto.
Fuck Alana, fuck Jonathan, fuck Wahid, all three. They were my closest friends. They're all fucked off. And my family. I never want to see them again either. Especially my parents circumcising me. No. Fuck you. That was mine. Fuck you.
I knew there was something I was forgetting. Alexander's deep, unending hatred towards his parents for getting him circumcised. It's something he spent years and years and years ranting about. Even going so far as to join support forums to talk about the plight of being circumcised. Now, the game dude thought he was pretty clever when he joined the foreskinrestoration.net, an inactivist network, because around this time, even though these posts were back from 2010, somebody on Encyclopedia Dramatica who was working on his article happened to find these, and he went back and edited every post he ever made, meaning that you couldn't find out what he was talking about. That's pretty clever, game dude. You really showed everybody. Except you forgot the fact that when somebody on that forum quotes a member, regardless of whether they edit their original post or not, the quote stays the same. So when these admins responded directly to you talking about your purchase of a TLC Tugger, and for those of you wondering what that is, here's a picture. I'll leave the rest up to your imagination. When those admins quoted you, they forever snapshotted what you had to say, so let's take a look. I don't have a retainer, but I suppose there's no harm in tugging 24/7. Guess I could just use the TLC Tugger without a strap, or MRS for less tension here or there. Is it safe to use that MRS remover stuff for the TLC Tugger to remove the sticky goo? When I apply the TLC Tugger, does there need to be like a millimeter of inner skin beneath the outer cone to know what I'm stretching? Otherwise, I assume the TLC Tugger would be stretching the shaft skin, since all the inner skin would be inside the cone. Would stretching slowly reduce the suture holes? How would a plastic surgeon fix them? And wouldn't that be really expensive? There's only like 3 together, and they're not that big. I started tugging with the strap at half its maximum length, causing way too much tension. After taking off the TLC Tugger, a liquid bubble, 2 red dots, and a small red line formed. What are they? And where did they come from? The next day, the liquid bubble and red line almost fully disappeared, but the 2 red dots barely minimized. Should I be concerned? I now have the strap at about 5 inches for maximum length, and it seems to be the perfect length. It does get slightly bothersome after 4 to 5 hours, though. Starting out, how many inches away from the tugger should I put the safety pin? Apparently, some people have experienced problems tugging at night. Should I avoid tugging at night for now? Well, Alexander, those are some fantastic questions. It's a shame that you remove them because people seeking the answers will never know. Now, with that out of the way, let's get to the manifesto. And the manifesto is really 2 things together. One is a blog that Alexander wrote detailing his entire experience. and the other is a series of videos he did explaining what happened. Both of these are retardedly long. The videos go on for upwards of hours, and the blog is basically a War and Peace version of a WordPress. There's far too much content to cover, so I'm going to try to hit the highlights for you. As I said, the manifesto, especially the blog portion of it, is a massive endeavor. It is a blog that he ran where he put up multiple parts explaining his interactions with Alana and everything surrounding all the events that had taken place over the last few years. And it is far too large of an undertaking for me to try to go through it in its entirety. Instead, I just want to focus on a few points of interest. I mean, after all, if a woman accuses you basically of stalking her, what better way to prove your innocence as a video game reviewer on YouTube than using video game characters to show that she was completely wrong? I know when I walk into court with the charge of stalking and harassment over my head that Pac-Man is the guaranteed solution to prove to the judge that I am in fact not crazy or stalkery at all. He even used cutting-edge CSI technology to render 3D landscapes to help really illustrate what happened in regards to the bushes incident. Clearly walking in a diagonal path towards those realistic bushes. And she just misinterpreted that because she didn't... They're transparent. You can see through the bushes, read the description. But perhaps the most interesting piece of information to really be gleaned from the entire blog itself is that Alexander himself is a victim. While she may claim that he bugged her, he harassed her, he maybe even stalked her, Alexander claims that Alana raped him. Alexander's main claim is that Alana raped him by deception, that she was cheating on him, that they didn't actually have an open relationship, and that by cheating on him, she was exposing him to the risk of STDs. Therefore, Alana is guilty of rape. We would have had sex numerously had I never seen this conversation. Therefore, she is either a rapist or an attempted rapist had she not technically already raped me when we got intimate and French kissed in her room after the lie. Even if it's far-fetched to call it rape, or even sexual assault, I still feel violated by my first love and best friend for around 3 years. Now, this is one of the points that Alexander actually brings up quite a bit, is that their open relationship wasn't open. He was cheated on. And that was the stress of the relationship. He does have a side to it, and he presents it in this manifesto that he wrote for everybody to come read. And it's really hard to go through all of that and digest it. The videos, on the other hand, a little more easy. His Mai Tai adventures as he's on the road to traveling. You can even look at the map to try to figure out where did this take place exactly? Was he in Vancouver? Was he in LA? Did he get to California? Was this the time that he was in Mexico? We know it's not Hong Kong. That doesn't happen for a few more years. So where in the world is Game Dude when he filmed this video?
The no contact rule for 1 month. Called her. I was drunk. So nervous. I got drunk to suppress the energy. Stupidest thing I ever did. Called her. She's like, stay the hell away from me. Fucking snapped. Called her a billion times. Got so depressed. Took 10 Advil tablets, thought it would do the trick. Yeah, dude, I was fucked. Just wanted the nightmare to end.
Now, as I sorted through this information and going over this story and the archive of all the screen caps and the videos and just everything that was there, it's hard to get a definitive timeline. Certain events don't really match up, and certain locations don't fit all events. I can say for certain that Alana and Alexander had a relationship, that relationship turned sour in the middle of 2012. That they tried to have a friendship or an open relationship, depending on who you're talking to, for upwards of a year after that. That following that, Alexander's behavior, even from his own admissions, became a bit over the top. That he began to violate, as he said, no contact orders, calling her up at all hours of the day. Even his own diagrams illustrating where the bushes are still show that he was going on her property. We know police reports were filed. We know that there was a court case coming up. Now, did he leave the country right before the court case? Did he leave it immediately after the court case? I don't know. Alexander had made statements saying that he actually did go to court. He went to court, and when she was supposed to take the witness stand, she had an emotional breakdown, ran out of the courtroom, and the case was dismissed. After which, he decided to flee the country because he was scared he'd get prosecuted again. So a lot of this is really, it's hard to pin down exactly what the fuck happened to the Game Dude. After 2015 or so, he did go to Hong Kong. He stated that in a few different messages to different individuals. And more recently, there's a short film that he was a part of that was catered by a company in Vancouver, so he must obviously have gone back to Canada at some point, but if he's still there, who knows? What we do know for certain is this, that when you put crazy up on the internet, it is forever there. That no matter which way the court case ended up breaking, no matter what the relationship with Alana looks like in this day and age, the record of your nutty ass behavior will forever be enshrined for anybody that cares to look it up. You could be the most innocent person in the world, but you still wrote a novel-length manifesto and filmed yourself playing with dinosaur toys, reenacting your breakup with the girl that doesn't want to talk to you anymore. But I suppose the upside is, even though the Game Dude's YouTube video reviews may have been complete and utter shit, his personal life sure is entertaining.